Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Good Catholic Podcast. I'm Peter Goen, and I'm sitting down today with our good friend, Father John Eckert. Father John, you've been a priest for, what, 12 years now. Yeah. And you recently had your ordination anniversary, so congratulations on that.
Thank you very much.
But we know Father John because he's been a lovely host for a few of our digital series. I think you joined us first for our Full of Grace series back in, was that 2019?
I think so,
or 2020. Yeah. But most recently for our Sacred Heart series, which we are promoting as we release this podcast, and you can sign up for that at goodcatholic.com. So that's mostly what we want to talk about today, and we can certainly talk about some other series too. You've done some behind the scenes with us before, we've sat down with you before, and it's always a pleasure. But as we look towards this Feast of the Sacred Heart and our Sacred Heart series, I just want to get real quick your kind of impression so far on how you've enjoyed or not enjoyed creating this series with us, and kind of what do you think is the most important thing about the kind of the Sacred Heart and what people have to gain from diving into it?
Thanks, Peter. And I appreciate being invited to get to be a part of the series, especially since I am the pastor of Sacred Heart Catholic Church in Salisbury, North Carolina. Mm-hmm. Like anything, it's nice when you can kind of dive in and study something more, and this gave us the opportunity to get to do that together as we've done in some other series. And I think, you know, as we just get that opportunity to spend some time reflecting on the great love that Jesus has for us. And, mm-hmm. and it's funny, because I think we talked about this a little bit in the series, where it's not just a Hallmark card.
Right.
You know, and it's one of those things that can almost seem kind of like, oh, you know, that's a nice sentiment and this and that. But when you think about it, it's like the love of Jesus Christ, it's the foundation of everything, you know, and to reflect on that and the fact that he has shown us such great love and he keeps pouring out it out on us. And it's like just keeps giving us that message time and time again that he loves us so much, that he's willing to go to this extent to show us that love, that his very heart is pierced with love for us, that it's on fire with love for us. And to get to go into the roots of that and the way we see it, you know, there in Scripture, in the history of the church, particularly with the teachings and revelations of certain saints, and then the effect that that has on our day-to-day life, it was just great to get to take some time and dive into those different elements and then what that means for us right now. It is so important, and I think, you know, especially being a place, like, you just say the name all the time, well, I'm at Sacred Heart, mm-hmm. and you can just sort of, like, throw the name away, you know, but it is so important, and to stop and recognize the depths of the meaning that's contained within that title, and I'm grateful we got to spend some time doing that together.
Yeah, well, it's always a pleasure to work with you. So to go back for a minute about that idea that, you know, it's not a Hallmark card, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, the love of God is such an easy thing to name and to talk about, in the sense that, oh yeah, Jesus loves you. And I know you just speak to a bit of this in the series, but if there's someone out there who maybe knows intellectually, yeah, God loves me, right? They've heard the gospel, or, you know, but they're just not feeling it.
Yeah.
You know, or there's that a certain malaise or maybe a certain complacency, and maybe they're even aware of it, you know, that's just, they don't really feel that love on their own part, or they're not really feeling that as an experience with our Lord. What kind of advice might you give them to kind of help break through that, or to kind of get past that spot of
malaise and dryness? Yeah, absolutely. Well, it almost kind of sounds counterintuitive in our very active world, because it's like, okay, here's the prescription. I want you to do these things. Mm-hmm. And on a certain level, I think, at least just from my own experience and kind of getting through, you know, the occasional malaise that can sort of hit any of us, is that you need to go and spend time with him. And to be in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament is such an important thing, whether that's with the Blessed Sacrament exposed on the altar in the monstrance, or visiting your local parish and just being with him in the tabernacle. And just to be there for a while. I mean, like anything with any of our relationships, sometimes we can gradually drift apart and not set that time aside. I mean, you kind of hear it said sometimes with, like, relationship experts, like the way that you know, spell love for people is T-I-M-E, you know, and to know that you, like, to set some time aside to just be in his presence is so important. And like I said, it's almost counterintuitive because it's like, oh, I'm kind of slow and bored. It's like, okay, well, go sit here and be quiet. You know, it's just not blah, blah. But there's a huge difference between, you know, just like doing that in your bedroom by yourself or like going to church and being with him in the Blessed Sacrament. There yeah. is something different. I mean, I'm really blessed, and we've had several of the series within the church building where I have right. the privilege of being pastor. It is a beautiful church, right? I mean, it's, I'm so blessed. I've celebrated the majority of the masses I've celebrated there. And it's an awesome thing to get to do that. But you go in any Catholic church in the world, there's a tabernacle. Our yeah. Lord is present. And even if it's not the most beautiful church in the world, Jesus is there. And so I think like any relationship to be with him is huge. Don't worry about, well, I have a hard time staying focused. Okay. He didn't create you to be a robot, right? Mm-hmm. Like this whole thing is like, he's showing us his love. He wants you to return your love back to him. And so to do some of that, just setting some time aside is incredibly helpful. And okay, you're having a hard time focusing. Bring scripture with you. You know, like read through. I think one of the best places you can go is read through the Last Supper discourse in the Gospel of John, 13-17. It's like, you know, it's so beautiful. Huge. It's so rich. I mean, it's like, okay, this is what he says to the apostles before he goes to die for them. There it is. It's like he's having a conversation with you. Read a little bit and then just sit with it for a while.
Yeah.
And it's a great thing. It's like you're listening to what he said to you. But this is the thing I think some people miss out on sometimes as well. You can talk to him about what's going on. Share your heart with him. Tell him where the ache is, like what's hurting, why you're concerned about X, Y, and Z, mm-hmm. you know, the problems in your relationship, job, family, I mean, wider world problems. There's always something to talk about, right? But to bring that to him is a really good thing to do.
And if I could just interject there.
Please do.
And I mean, I'm not the priest in the room, but I'll add a little bit of advice. In terms of talking to our Lord, you don't have to make that a burdensome thing.
No.
You know, I mean, it's incredibly important to bring like your deepest pains and, mm-hmm. and your sufferings and your crosses and all of that before the Lord. And that's so huge and so important. But it doesn't have to just be that, because if you exclusively think about your time with the Lord as that, this kind of earth-moving experience, though that can happen and that can transform and that is good, like you can, I don't know, you can talk about your day in a sense.
Absolutely.
Like, yeah, absolutely. He knows what you're doing, but talk about whatever it is, you know?
Well, completely.
Just share your day.
Yeah. Just like, you know, like having a conversation with loved ones.
Yeah.
It's just tell me about your day.
Right.
And you know, and our Lord has a way too of revealing things that have happened in your day too. It's like, well, I was present in this.
Right.
And it's like, oh my goodness, like how, like a chance encounter that becomes something a whole lot deeper as our Lord sort of kind of shows that to you while you're there in prayer. And you're absolutely right. And so you don't want to just go to him when things are difficult. I mean, you should keep going to him. But like any kind of friends, like, it's difficult on a relationship when you only contact me because you're having a hard time. You know, like, you want to have the good times too. And he wants that. He wants to be present. And, you know, he shows us, look how much I love you. And because he loves us so much, he wants us to be there with him. He wants us to share with him our joys and our sufferings, our good times and our bad times, like all of these different things. And I think, just that being there with him doesn't have to be all day. You know, like it's okay. Like I know the majority of people who are going to listen to this are probably not consecrated religious or priests. But they're, you know, just to find that sometime during the week that, hey, I'm driving home, I'm going to pop by the parish and be there for a little while.
Yeah. No, I think that's a great piece of advice. So to turn a little bit now to the Sacred Heart series.
Yeah.
Although I suppose this could apply to the last few series we've done, because you joined us recently for the Five Precepts and then Our Lady of Lourdes.
Yeah.
You know, the Lourdes, the True Story back in January.
January, yeah, that's right.
But what recently for you has been kind of the hardest topic to chew through and to prepare for in regards to the Sacred Heart? Or the other series?
It's a good question. I mean, when it came to Sacred Heart in general, in a way, it's kind of embarrassing. It's like, I've been pastor there for 8 years. I should be like an expert, and I am not. You know? And like, I don't know enough about the different saints, you know, like Saint Gertrude, Saint Mechtild, Saint John Eudes. Mm-hmm. So to get to study them a bit or read some of the different documents that are available, like, and I forget the name of the title, but the one that Pope Pius XII put out in, I think, 1956. Mm-hmm. So just to, I think sometimes the hardest part is just getting the time to stop and read and do these things. You know, just because parish life, it's busy. Yeah. Just like we're all busy, you know, but the way I kind of equate us doing these series, it's sort of like you get assigned a big project at school, and it's a group project because right. You and I are working together. And, you know, so to make the time for us to get together and mm-hmm. work on it, more than anything, it's just setting aside the time to make it happen. Because with all of them, I mean, I guess the precepts were probably the easiest because it's like, here's these five things that mm-hmm. quite frankly are kind of no-brainers.
Right.
And it's like, hey, here's the bare minimum. Now let's jump off of this and do better.
Right.
And that was kind of fun to do. And truth be told, when you called me about that one, I was like, I don't think I can pull this off. I mean, like, it's just, we're talking about May here. Like, it's the end of the school year. We got in all the sacraments, all this. But you talked me into it. And
roped you in.
Yeah, you roped me right in. But I'm grateful that we did it. And that one, too, it's like the research was not as difficult on that one. It's like, mm-hmm. here's a couple paragraphs from the catechism, and there you go. But you know, with Sacred Heart, there's, you know, a couple of books to kind of dive into. Yep. There's different devotional practices, like the enthronement of the Sacred Heart.
Yep.
One of my parishioners, Maria Perkins, provided me with the information on that. So I appreciate that from Mrs. Perkins. She's wonderful. You know, like things along those lines, just trying to kind of collect the information. And then the hardest thing is just kind of getting the time to study it. Mm-hmm. However, and I'm sure it's kind of the same for you, after having put in the effort, you appreciate it.
Oh, yeah.
It's so good.
For sure. I mean, speaking of precepts,
yeah,
I was like, wow, these things are underrated.
They really are.
They're so underrated.
Absolutely.
You know, because like you said, it was kind of fun to do it. And we say, this is the bare minimum. Let's go do better. It's like, oh, but this is the bare minimum because doing this will point you to mm-hmm. the fullness of everything else.
Absolutely. And I mean, kind of goes back to your question from a minute ago. I'm kind of this malaise, da da da. Well, okay. Are you doing all these things and doing them to the fullest? You know, like what is your Sunday like? Are you kind of resting from servile labor, or is every day exactly the same? Or are you going through some recreation on Sunday that helps you to recognize, oh, yeah, I'm loved by God who has risen from the dead. And like, this world is not all that there is, and that I can be recreated in his image and join in recreation and go play a game with the kids in the backyard. You know, like there's so many good things and all of those precepts. Yeah, sometimes they take a little bit of work, you know, as we discuss, like, okay, you've got to get to Mass on Sunday. And okay, once again, I'm a celibate priest. I got to take care of myself and get myself there. And that's hard enough. Like, I know people mm-hmm. with kids. It's
right.
not easy. I'm really blessed. My sister has six little guys. She's pregnant with number seven, which I'm super excited about. And actually, so the oldest is a girl. Then it's five boys. And she just found out number seven is another girl. So it's very exciting. But like, when I get to go up and stay with them, they live up in Illinois where we mm-hmm. grew up. I love it because I get to be in the mix for getting everything ready to get to Mass, right? And, oh, it's so much fun, but mm-hmm. it's crazy, you know? And but God bless them. They get there on time, and they're there. And, you know, all six of the kids, Chris, my brother-in-law, Katie, my sister, and they make it, and they help out, and they do things. It's like, okay, if they can do this. Now, granted, it's my job. Like, I'm gonna go. But you know, it's just to see that and see the joy that comes from it.
Right.
And it's so worth it. And I think, you know, when people just kind of like let that fall, it's like, well, we got important things going on. It's like, there's nothing more important. I promise you. Like, I get it. There's a lot of involvements and there's a lot of pressures. But it's sort of like the advice from St. Francis de Sales, where he said, okay, you need to pray for a half hour every day, except for when you're busy. When you're busy, pray for an hour. Mm-hmm. And I love that, because at first it sounds counterintuitive, like he got his math wrong. But it's so true. We need that weekly celebration of the resurrection, you know, rooted in the source and summit of our faith, the Eucharist, to go through another week, to keep loving our family, which quite frankly, as a confessor, is a thing that most people struggle with. Like, mm-hmm. there aren't, you know, it's not like constant murders out there. What the problem is, it's like, we're not patient and loving with the people we live with. And you look at the love of the Sacred Heart, he wants us to love too. And he gives us the grace to do it, but we got to keep showing up.
Yeah.
And if you stay away from that, you lose the grace, the sacramental just power that comes into your life and allows you to, quite frankly, enjoy day-to-day life. Does it make it easy? No.
Right.
But it makes it good.
And hearing all of that, it just strikes me, again, the symbolism of the Sacred Heart as wreathed in the crown of thorns.
Yeah.
You know, that because it's this burning love of God, this ardent love of God. These are the words that Christ uses
mm-hmm.
to describe his Sacred Heart to Saint Margaret Mary. But then it's wrapped in thorns.
Yeah.
You know, and there's the crucifixion there. There's this pain there. This is self-sacrifice within that, which we are called to embody ourselves.
Absolutely.
You know,
and just, you know, meditating on the fact that the second person of the Most Holy Trinity, God himself, you know, voluntarily takes that on. Like, and it's like if you go back to the malaise, the lukewarm mm-hmm. thing, right? To have that reaction to Christ, I mean, that causes the crown of thorns. I mean, not to put too fine a point on it, but you know, when you think about, like, if you go out of your way to, let's say, recognize your anniversary with your wife and you mm-hmm. make this huge dinner and you do everything you can to, like, make, you know, make the house look amazing and set it all up, and she comes in and goes, "Nah, I'm going to bed." Like, that would, like, pierce yeah. you to the heart. So you think about all that our Lord has done for us, every way that he just keeps telling us he loves us, you know, sending his mother time and time again. We go back to the Lord series, right? You think about the Divine Mercy apparitions, you know, to Saint Faustina. Jesus, I trust in you. It's like, what does he want from us? He wants us to trust him, right? He wants yeah. us to know that he is present and to stop being afraid of everything. In Psalm 53, we get in the breviary from time to time where it's, you know, they tremble with fear with no cause for fear. Now, granted, I know there's a lot of scary stuff going on out there, but at the end of the day, it's like we've won the war, you know, and mm-hmm. our Lord is risen from the dead. And he's there with us. And I think, you know, it's sort of like in the book of Revelation. I wish you were either hot or cold, but this lukewarm, it just spits right. you out of my mouth. Well, to respond to that kind of, you know, infinite outpouring of love with, meh, it's just, you can understand how that would pierce him because he loves us and wants us to return it. And so, and yeah, and we can all fall into that trap. Yeah. I think sloth and just a general not caring is kind of an epidemic in what we, mm-hmm. you know, what's around yeah. us right now. But each of us can counteract that with just small acts of devotion, like support, just spending time with him, just momentary, thank you, Jesus. You know, like I will say, those little signs, I don't know where they came from. I think some, like, a little boy, like, made them up and they sell them all over the place that say, thank you, Jesus, that are just in people's yards. I kind of like seeing those sometimes. I know it's kind of corny, it's a quick little thing, but, you know, just like momentary things throughout the day. It's just like, thank you, you know, and thank you for loving me. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for being with me right now. And so it's like meditating on the love that he gives us. Yes, some don't return it, but we can make up for that by loving him and then trying to, you know, warm them up away from the lukewarmness, mm-hmm. like by our genuine love to hopefully encourage others to love him as well.
Yeah. Oh, amen. Amen. So you mentioned, that kind of already answers the question, but you mentioned when we were talking, when we were preparing, we were doing one of our sit downs before we made this series, about how doing these series and especially doing Sacred Heart kind of helps you in your own vocation.
Absolutely.
That it's not just this extraneous thing, you know? And I think you even just spoke to a little bit as to why,
mm-hmm.
you know, about how learning about the Sacred Heart and trying to foster that devotion within yourself helps you even in your day to day as a pastor of souls and as the pastor of a parish.
Absolutely. And we just had our eighth grade graduation 2 weeks ago, basically, at this mm-hmm. point. And our eighth grade teacher is just wonderful. Made this comment to them about, you know, you're graduating. Now, obviously, they're going to high school. Like, they're still going to be in school
yeah,
for a
yeah.
while. But it's like, look, you know, you're going to be lifelong learners. You know, they're, yeah. And we just celebrated the Solemnity of the Holy Trinity. You know, our Deacon Darren Balke is about to be ordained a priest. He preached our parish this weekend. It was great. We talked about, you know, the Trinity is not a problem to be solved, But it's a mystery that we can continue to dive into deeper and deeper. And so for any of us, like, it doesn't matter if you have a doctorate in theology, or, you know, if you've just been Catholic a long time, or you're new to the faith, or any of this, there's always more to learn. And when you think about the Sacred Heart, at the heart, especially scripturally speaking in the Old Testament, it's not just about emotions. Like, the place of the emotions in the Old Testament was in the guts. And that's the way they say it, which is kind of fun. It's like his guts removed. And yeah, anyway, we won't go into it. I don't know.
Don't think about it too much.
Yeah, exactly. But it's like the heart, yes, it contains the emotions, but also the intellect and the will. And so anytime we can study more and learn, and there's always more things to learn, it just helps. Our faith is, you can always go deeper. It's something that, you know, it's accessible for anybody. Like, you know, I get to, you know, go see one of my nieces later on, and she loves the faith and is learning about all the time. She's still in grade school. But, like, seeing her joy and her learn about things, like, helps me to keep growing in it too. And I can keep studying with you and presenting these things, but there's always more to be learning, which in turn helps me to love our Lord more, you know, helps the emotions, helps the will, you know, helps in difficult moments to cling even closer to him, mm-hmm. or to, you know, find out new information about, say, Margaret Mary Alacoque, who's in one of our stained glass windows right there at the front of the church. And in fact, her relic is right above our tabernacle too, which is kind of a cool thing.
That's really neat.
So, you know, like, so getting to study about her, that's only going to help in my work as a priest. And so, I mean, specifically as a priest, that helps. But for any of us Christians, we're baptized to learn about our rich inheritance of the faith and the life of Christ within us, it's always going to be a big help. And I think the Sacred Heart is one of those, like, pinnacle sort of things of, like, okay, this summarizes it so beautifully.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we're big on that. Obviously, at Good Catholic, we do a lot of, you know, learn more, you know, kind of trying to serve the intellectual side. And we do a lot of devotional stuff and trying to help you kind of on that, I don't know, let's broadly call it the emotional component. But that love isn't just one thing, you know, like, it isn't just one side of the coin. You can learn, or you can love God better by learning more about him.
Absolutely.
And if you learn more about him without striving to love him in your actions, then
it's a dangerous place to be.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, he's not a subject to be studied in the lab and then you just let it go and go home. I mean, it's all-encompassing. I mean, there is a legitimate and important place of, like, theological studies.
Right.
I mean, that's what I had to do in seminary, and I'm grateful that I got to. And you need solid foundation, solid principles, all these good things. But it doesn't end there. I mean, I know Pope Francis has talked about, and others have too, like, you know, like, theology on your knees or you know, things like that. And that's good. And I mean, that's been the rich, long tradition of the church.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more of a modern invention that it's sort of like, okay, it's pluck somehow that
separate.
Out.
Yeah. Yeah.
It does. It's like studying theology, studying sacred scripture without faith.
Yeah.
It just, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
Well, it's like Thomas Aquinas himself, right? Aside from his example of holiness, I mean, he wrote the Tantum Ergo, right? He wrote these hymns for Corpus Christi.
Yeah.
You know, he is, his writings, I mean, in the Summa, yes, but when you read about what he wrote elsewhere or just what he said elsewhere, like, there's this clear relationship and this ardent desire to be with the Lord that permeates everything else.
Absolutely.
You know, and it's that kind of desire and that kind of love that creates everything else.
Absolutely. And it just, and it affects everything, and not just on an intellectual level.
Right.
But then that, it's like the fire from that ignites everything else you do, gives you the ability not just to learn more and more about sacred scripture, as important as that is, to learn more and more about the saints, as important as that is, but to love your family, you know, and to be a, you know, transparent person of integrity in your workplace. Because we need those. And, you know, just good people on the ground who do these things not because they're going to get rewarded. Because a lot of times you're not going to get rewarded. And I think, I mean, heck, we could see Roe v. Wade overturned any day, right? Which I really hope we do. But that's going to present its own challenges in the world. And we got to be able to stand up. And it's not, like, we can't do it because we're expecting applause. We got to do it because we love Jesus Christ. and we love the people he has placed in our life. And that includes those who are going to be just throwing vitriol at us because we stand up for the dignity of human life.
Yeah.
We don't respond in kind with hatred. We pray for their conversion, which, I mean, it's like being risen from the dead. I mean, that kind of a conversion in a way is more impactful than Lazarus being raised from the dead because it has eternal consequences. And like Lazarus eventually died physically again. We can't go to the Holy Land and just shake his hand, right? I mean, but, you know, I would assume he, Martha, and Mary, like best friends of Jesus, I would guess he's in heaven. Like, I never hear him called Saint Lazarus.
I think they are revered as saints.
I would think
it's
so.
It's one of those things like King David is in the canon of saints, but we don't call him Saint.
Exactly.
David.
Exactly.
You know, Abraham.
One of my favorite comments along those lines is when you talk about the Blessed Mother and people and people like, are they ever going to canonize her? Because she's still a blessed. I love it when you're it's like, she's in. It's fine. Don't worry about that.
Yeah, and it's just like an English language.
I love that.
Like the Italians call her Santa Maria.
Exactly. Exactly. I love those sort of little things. But it's like, you know, in our Blessed Mother, just like at Lourdes, we talked about that series, where at one point she like looks up from Bernadette and like looks off in the distance and looks sad and then looks back and says, pray for poor sinners. And, you know, and that's what we have to do. And I think this is part of the good work we get to participate in this is sharing the goodness that we have. Because like, why do you want to pray for the conversion of poor sinners? Because we have like this infinite gift that Christ has given us, namely himself. And he's given us all these amazing helps, in particular, his Blessed Mother, to help us to enter into that. And the amazing thing is he wants us to participate in that. And I mean, I get the awesome pleasure, privilege, honor of getting to do that with you all in these videos, but also as a priest in the parish, and you know, and you get to do that and writing the wonderful articles and us working on the videos, and Zach gets to do it in the filming and putting it all together. I mean, it's like we all have our part to play, and it's a little bit different for everybody, but at the end of the day, we get to share this infinite treasure. And it's not like as we've done this, it's like, we're running out of the treasure because too many people are buying in. It's like, no, I mean, it's the infinite love of Christ. And so to get to participate in that and help to share that is just, it's an awesome gift. So even, there's challenges at the time level of it sometimes, but it's always totally worth it. I'm always appreciative for what I've picked up and getting to participate in the series.
Well, that's great to hear. Well, I think we'll start to wrap up in just a minute here. But
sure.
For any subscribers who are going to go through the Sacred Heart series, right, assuming you do one series per day, and you might go faster, a little bit slower, you know, might go at your own pace, but it's about a 2-week kind of self-guided retreat on the Sacred Heart. Any particular tips or words of wisdom for folks who are kind of about to undergo that, starting on the Feast of the Sacred Heart?
I would say, wow, it's a really good question. I think, you know, inviting the Holy Spirit in from the beginning, asking for just that guidance through it all, to see the scriptures that we meditate upon, you know, in a new light. Because it's the thing, anytime you kind of reference certain things, like the Last Supper discourse or, you know, from the Passion, we've heard these things so many times. But that love of our Lord is ever ancient and ever new. To ask for that grace to be able to enter into that more and more, to be surprised anew by the beauty of sacred scripture. The other thing, you know, it's like as you kind of get to the points with the saints, I think sometimes we find like saints kind of intimidating, or we think, you know, we put them up on a pedestal and that's the end of them. Like Dorothy Day, I guess, used to say, like someone called her a saint. She's like, don't make me irrelevant that quickly. You know, and basically what she meant was it's like, you know, once someone's canonized, it's like people assume like, well, I could never be like that. But that's not the case. I mean, they lived in a real place, a real time, a real context. Like it was, we talk about Jansenism. I mean, there you go. There's one of the big struggles of the day. And yet God continues to interact in that. Jesus comes to Margaret Mary Alacoque and says, let him know about my Sacred Heart. Like, I love you. Please come and see that. And so to recognize that, yes, we look at Margaret Mary Alacoque and she's up there in the stained glass window and it's beautiful. But that doesn't mean that you can't do similar things. Like you are called to be a saint. And I think sometimes we sort of take that and then like make it this unattainable ideal, like, oh, that's neat, but don't do that. I mean, you know, God sanctifies the ordinary. And as we look at the incarnational aspects of the Sacred Heart, it's like he has a heart like you have a heart. And at the end of the litany of the Sacred Heart, it's like, oh, Jesus, meek and humble of heart, make my heart like unto thine. He wants your heart to be like his heart. That stuff isn't just said and like, oh, that's neat. You know, mm-hmm. like, no, like, this is true. It's so much more true than, hey, kiddo, you can be whatever you want to be. It's not true. Like, I was never going to be an NBA player. Like, I'm not tall. I'm not mm-hmm. fast. I can't shoot that well. Like, it was never on the realm of possibilities. I could have worked so hard from the time I was four until now. I wouldn't be in the NBA. It's okay. I'm fine with that. But everybody created in the image and likeness of God, which is every human being, is called to be a saint. Like, you are called to have a heart like unto the heart of Jesus Christ, right? And so I would say, as you enter into this, avoid the temptation of like keeping the bar low. It almost, like, all of it, it sounds too good to be true, but it's not too good to be true. It's so good. And it's one of those amazing things about our faith, is that it's the sort of thing that is so good that, like, we couldn't have come up with this, you know?
Right.
Human beings couldn't have, have invented
yeah.
the God who becomes one yeah. of us and dies for our sake, even though everybody betrays him right and left yeah. and all this, and still rises from the dead and still says, peace be with you.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's just, and, you know, whoever sins you forgive or forgiven. Like, he, even though he knows we're going to keep screwing up, he keeps calling us to his Sacred Heart.
Yeah.
So realizing, yes, it all sounds just so amazing, and it is. And you can enter into that and make it the reality in your life all the time.
Well, thank you for sharing.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, I think we'll wrap it up there.
Sounds great.
Father, it's great to have you in studio again today.
Peter, it's always great to be back.
Thank you for listening to the Good Catholic Podcast. If you enjoyed spending this time with me and with Father Eckert, consider signing up for our Good Catholic digital series, The Sacred Heart. The first sessions will be available on the Feast of the Sacred Heart on June 24th, and you'll join me, Father Eckert, and thousands of other Catholics on a journey into Christ's transformational love. Sign up at goodcatholic.com or by following the link in the description of this podcast. You can also visit goodcatholic.com for more inspirational content, like intriguing articles, free videos, and other podcasts just like this one. Thanks for joining, and God bless.